with the papers of the department's purposes.
Say that the pattern language was created to generate the environment indirectly, that are geological or organic are generated by the Metico. So what the idea leads us with biomimetic architecture, seeking solution by understanding the rules governing natural forms, but not just replicating them. That is looking for the rules of its genetic code that generates the form. The drawback is that in practice most of the time it just imitates form and do not adapt the process behind them. And besides seeking processes in nature could bring some innovation in architecture, it could be more useful trying to identify human processes. Although they will probably be more complex to understand. And here is where Christopher Alexander patterns of space seems to be useful to reduce that complexity because they simplify human relations with space to a few parameters. So we can see how biomimetic architecture tries to identify the relations in a form, in a natural form, and reduce it to a parametric algorithm to can replicate it. But in a human environment, a human relation with space, we need a system of patterns to reduce it in a parametric decomposition to generate the work. So let's say that Patrick Schumacher that established the difference between parametric and pathological architecture by the change of form, avoiding really primitive geometric primitives and considering all forms to be parametrical malleable. But this idea seems to me to be a bit vague because it just refers to physical forms and aesthetics and has not the sense of relation, topological relation between the space and the human response. The idea of using patterns in parametric architecture allows us to think of a potential form architecture considering just the relation that should generate the space and not the form of the space itself. From this point of view, a change of style or ideology can depend just on a formal change, but in a social transformation. It's a transformation in the patterns of space. This means that a deep change in architecture just can happen if parametric. And digital tools are not only used for computer aided design and manufacturing, that is just for change physical forms, but also if they are used for a kind of computer aided conceptualization. The way we think in architecture. That's the limit of just being able to think and project. What we can design is overcoming. We can think a project not by designing it, but by establishing the rules that would generate it. So this means that we should then refuse parametric methodologies, but also that it's necessary to implement more complexity. Until now, it's focused in environment, environmental parameters or in quantitative human information linked with geometric form, but it's possible to implement qualitative information that implies topological response and combine it with other approaches. So now we have control the environmental parameters like insulation, lights, temperature, sound, noise, and even some quantitative human information. But we can also add more topological information by the patterns. So regarding this complementarity between parametric architecture and pattern language, we can say that it improves both qualitative and quantitative characteristics. Parametric architecture generates architectural forms responding to environment, being shareable and reusable because of being digital. On the other hand, patterns generate topological spatial relation and response to human constraints. Being well defined, but not digital, so it's difficult to share them. Therefore, in conclusion, we can say that with the complementarity between patterns and parameters, parametric architecture could respond to environment and users, and patterns could be shared and reused in digital. So what is pattern language and why it needs a parametric approach? For understanding what the pattern language is, we need to understand the unit that composes the language. This is the pattern. So each pattern describes a problem which occurs over and over again in our environment, and then describes the core of the solution to that problem in such a way that you can use the solution a million times over without ever doing it in the same way twice. This is the definition by Alexander for a pattern, and under it we can see a design of a pattern by him that shows how it's tried to find a simple way of representing a model that is not a fixed solution, but a specific abstract solution that defines it. On the right, we can see how the patterns have a lot in common with parametric architecture, combining Alexander's quote with Polaric's one. So instead of articulate an internal logic of Polaric set, Alexander says and describes the core of the solution. And instead of have a range of possibilities, Alexander says that it's possible to use the solution and the time solver without ever doing some weird parts. In that way, we see how patterns can be adapted to parametric things, and also how the pattern language can grow. The idea of this in our synergetic system is common to both. The pattern language is then defined, not just by the patterns, but also by the relation between them. Just as the algorithmic logic is defined by the patterns and the rules that combine them. The representation of the pattern language as a tree is a common way to represent it. Just look for making it easier to understand, but it works as a network and as modifier. So thinking of them from a fractal approach, the pattern language or the parametric pattern language can be seen as another network inside the parametric one, composed by form, structure, areas, function, and so on. That is a synergetic network that combined will make finally the grid. So it's composed in that network could be, the network could represent the pattern language, but also in another scale, the pattern language can be just a component inside this network. In order to find an inspired pattern, which Alexander says is just an hypothesis, he looked for a repetitive conflict in the environment, combining the correct and wrong solutions, and then defining a general solution to the conflict that includes the correct correct ones and excludes the wrong ones. The problem is that they are just hypotheses, also testing empirically. We need to criticize and correct them, but it's difficult to share the improvements if the pattern has just published in a book. This problem can be solved now by information technologies if the patterns were digitalized. That idea of sharing patterns digitally is given by their own evolution. After a pattern language was published, patterns have already been used in architecture, but programmers have adopted the methodology of Alexander to create the software design patterns, as you see before. And also in 2010, Robert Goodrich published Elements of Parametric Design, which combined the software design pattern with a kind of programming coding patterns that solves CAD common problems. The benefit of that software design patterns or elements of parametric design is that they aren't just theoretical, as Alexander patterns are, but their solutions are reusable directly by a program that can be criticized, correct, and shared by anyone, improving them continuously. Then, why are the patterns not used? Is the question I have. And there are three issues that can be considered as the problems of the pattern language. The first one is that it's complex to use. It's necessary to select the patterns, understand and link them together, and then make all the progress. The second point is that they are difficult to correct and share, so we can be sure about the correction of patterns. But as we explained before, those problems can be solved with digital tools. The issue that seems to be more important for not using patterns is that we look at them and they seem to limit creativity and innovation architecture. But this is false. In the design, you can see the representation of the pattern pulled in the auto room, one of the most important for my investigation because I'm trying to evaluate them based on the certain gallery pavilions that respond to these patterns. And we see how the archaic representation by Alexander has the same user properties as the parametric fashion model. So we can design a pattern in infinite possibilities. The other conclusion that can be taken from the pavilions analysis is that in a project, patterns are always used. The drawback is that we use them unconsciously, just trying to imitate the characteristics of a space, that in our memory, often called intuition, seem to be comfortable or good. In that way, just if we use them constantly, we can accumulate knowledge. Otherwise, we will be trying to reinvent the wheel again. If we try to digitalize a pattern, it's necessary to find the parameters that compose the core field. The solution of Alexander would be just for the essential characteristics that define each pattern and have the parameters intrinsic to them. In this example, the seed spots are defined or solved by the parameters related to views, limit, sun, shades, winds, protection, and activities. But however, it's not easy to parameterize them because we have the parameters, but it's necessary to find the logic that links them, which in this case is different if there are seed spots for summer or for winter. And then we will have some output parameters. The image on the right shows us how the complexity is still increasing when the patterns are linked in a pattern image, having parameters that are connected to several patterns and having output parameters of the larger patterns that works as inputs for the smaller one. So can a pattern be parameterized? Is it possible to digitalize a pattern language? Well, it's difficult to respond to that, but I tried to make some experiences parameterizing some patterns, like the last one, six spots, because it's the simpler and smaller pattern applicable to my case of study, the serpentine pavilions. And the inputs parameters that define the pattern are, as we said before, the views to some activity, then the insulation shade or space, and the winds. And they are correlated to obtain a visualization of the potential space to choose for us in the salon experience. But if what I was trying to represent how a pattern defined theoretical, or how we see it here, can be parameterized to obtain a visualization of it. But it's not so simple like that. Here I like to show the complexity of doing a project patternized from conceptualization. The problem is not just the complexity of linking all the patterns or control the parameters, but doing it without a form, without a program, or simply without areas. But theoretically, it would be possible to digitalize it with the necessary knowledge of programming, just by linking the input parameters with the patterns, having the output information to control the design regarding the formal components. So it's that example of the pattern language I'm following to analyze the pavilions, and I try to design the response that it will have in a design of another pavilion, but it's difficult to connect the patterns together. So the problem is that each parametric pattern should be as simple to work by itself and so complex that it can be used within the language. This means that each pattern depends not only on its input parameter, but also in larger patterns, output parameters. So finally, we will talk about the parametric patterns. What the function is, why are they just possible in a topological architecture and not in a physical way, and what the digital morphogenesis should represent. What we said before, when talking about networks, a parametric pattern language cannot make a building by itself. It can just define a parametric conceptualization of it and evolve during the project. So looking at the sketch, we see that the pattern language is something abstract, just a network with information and relation. But however, we need a way to visualize it to kind of use it for design. And this way of visualizing it needs to be topological, not with a form. Furthermore, we need to control and quantify the parametric logic with the parameters, input and output, how we see here, and the patterns by a digital algorithm. So, that idea of topological architecture allows us to think of a project as a system of forces that interact, change, and adapt together, form, environment, and users. So, as we said before, now architecture can be generated and not designed. In that kind of approach, the importance of digital tools, science and mathematics is fundamental because without them it's not possible to move from theory to practice. And finally, we will repeat that quote of Polaret because the digital morphogenesis could be a great advance in architecture, but we need to be cautious. The architect should be the person who chooses the pattern and defines the generative logic, whereas the computer just calculates that algorithm, controlling all the information on parameters while offering a range of possibilities for the architect and also the users, the public, to choose the most appropriate one. As conclusion, just in these four issues, architecture is much more than intuition, and patterns or digital architecture should not limit the creativity of the architect, but improve the possibility we have. Digital tools and mathematics are necessary and inevitable, so we must rethink about the constraints and disadvantages of them and propose new solutions and agendas. Digital morphogenesis could represent an evolution architecture, but it can also become a trap if it turns into architecture designed by computers. And patterns and parameters may not be the best solution for that goal because they cannot achieve the necessary complexity, as we have said before, with shared grammars could complement that approach, but they can be a start point to improve our vision of architecture.